So once a child is being abused, he kind of loses his ability because of confusion. He has no words to say no. So you tell the child, shout no. Is it possible if I tell you just shout no? Like even as adults, you know, if someone just comes and tries to attack us, would you like, I think I would be, you know, dumbfounded for a while, for a few minutes at least. And those few minutes are the crucial minutes in which the abuser will just clamp down on the child. So it's not easy to say no. Then slowly from affection, they move to threatening. So they start saying, okay, if you tell anyone, I will kill you, or I will kill your sister, or I will kill your mother. And the children, as they are very literal creatures, they will think, oh, my mother will die. Let me not do that. So majority of children who are abused and who continue to be abused for many years together have this fear in their mind that their father or their mother or their sister will be killed or something will happen to them. And that is why they continue to endure the abuse without saying anything. Of course, they are also full of guilt. The guilt keeps growing and growing. So the first day they are guilty of eating the chocolate. The second day they're guilty of allowing the person to touch them in a place which is not supposed to be touched, and still they have not told anyone. And then that keeps growing, you know, the guilt keeps growing. You allow more and more of it and it keeps becoming worse and worse. Children become loners. They stop talking altogether, they stop interacting with anyone, and they develop this double personality. So in front of others, they're like really happy and you would never suspect that something is happening to this child. Inside, the child is like a totally, you know, a nervous wreck inside because of the abuse. They come up with all these small things, my stomach is aching, my head is paining, I don't want to go, stuff like that, you know. And we're like, oh, she's always making excuses not to go to school, or she doesn't want to do her homework, or she doesn't want to go for tuition, she doesn't want to go for tennis class. Whenever she has tennis class, she says, oh, I'm having a stomach ache. And then after 5 minutes, she's playing. So there is something about that tennis class or about that tuition class. Something is there. You know, do not dismiss it literally. And basically the child becomes a reticent person. There's low self-esteem, so you're not doing the right thing. So naturally your self-esteem is sinking and sinking and sinking and sinking. This anxiety, what if someone else finds out? What if my father is killed? What if my mother is killed? What if something happens? And then the child is depressed. And this just takes you spiraling lower and lower and lower and lower. I mean, even as adults, if you imagine a situation like this, it's terrible. I mean, from low esteem to anxiety to depression because you're being abused by somebody, it's unimaginable even for us. So for children, it's terrible. So of course, children should be taught about sexual abuse. In fact, at the end of the lecture, I'm going to what you should teach your children about sexual abuse. But they shouldn't have to prevent the sexual abuse by themselves. So by telling children, okay, now I have taught my child about the private parts. I've told him no one should touch the private parts. And now I'm through. That is wrong. I've taught him about stranger danger, I've taught him about private parts, I've said nobody should touch private parts, and now I'm through with my responsibility. My child will be able to protect himself or herself from sexual abuse. That's not going to happen. And no matter how much responsibility we put on other adults, it's never going to happen. So you say, okay, I'm going to send her to a completely safe school. So there are completely safe schools. That protection has to come from you, from within the parent. That is very, very important.